عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Alhamdulillah again. Assalamu alaikum, everyone. Welcome to this wonderful class. I'm really excited for this class. Alhamdulillah. I wanted to actually begin first by sharing a dua for studying something that I'm endeavoring. It's one of my goals this Ramadan that I've memorized this dua. So I figured, inshallah, I can share it here with all of you as well. So I'm going to quickly screen share. And I just have this image here for us to read from. And I encourage all of you to, if you can, you can actually purchase this if you want from the Zaytuna College bookstore. But it's a really beautiful dua that I think all of us, we're all students of knowledge. Hopefully we all see ourselves as lifelong learners and students of knowledge, that we are mindful to really call on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even when we're in spaces like this, learning from each other, inshallah. So, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin al-Fatiha lima ughliq. والخاتم لما سبق ناصر الحق بالحق على هادي إلى صراطك المستقيم وعلى آله حق قدره ومقداره العظيم اللهم افتح علينا فتوح العارفين ووفقنا توفيق الصالحين وانفعنا اللهم بالقرآن وذكر الحكيم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما يقربنا منك برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم لا سحر إلا ما جعلته سحرا وأنت يا حي يا قيوم تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سحرا سحلا اللهم عذنا من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا وأصلح لنا شأننا كله لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. So alhamdulillah, you can see here the meaning of this dua, mashallah. It's beautiful, and it really, I think, puts us all, it puts me, inshallah, all of us in a state of humility where we are really asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this path of studying his deen easy and give us tawfiq and to make us sincere, inshallah. So again, you can get this. It's a really beautiful poster. You can get it from Zaytuna College, but I do encourage you to memorize it. And if you want to take a quick screenshot of it for now, you can do that. You can also do a Google search for it. Just do supplication for studying Zaytuna College and you'll see this image, inshallah. So with that said, I'm going to now share the document that I really am excited to read with all of you. It's something that has absolutely impacted my life. And I think that's precisely why our teachers, mashallah, translated it, and it taught us to study it, because they wanted us to benefit from the saints of our tradition, who just had so much insight and really helped to help us to navigate our path even now, centuries later. I mean, it's just amazing. So actually, I'm so sorry. If you give me a moment, I apologize. 1 second. I have some noise coming from the back. Hold on. Sorry, my husband and sons are assembling something and I think they forgot I had class. So I had to just let them know. Thank you. All right. So alhamdulillah. I'm sorry, I'm looking for my notes here. Oh yeah, I just wanted to do a quick biography. Some may wonder what, you know, if I hope you got the PDF. I know it was sent, the PDF of the document, but if you're not familiar with who Sidi Ahmad Zarruq is, his biography is really powerful too, just knowing who he is. He's a 15th century scholar from Morocco, Fez, Morocco, to be specific. He has different titles, Ahmed Zarruq, Imam Az-Zarruq, Shihab Ad-Din, Abu Al-Abbas, Ahmed bin Muhammad bin Isa Al-Barnusi Al-Fasi. That's the long name, mashallah, that he was given. But he was born in Morocco, and he has, again, many beautiful titles. One of his titles is Muhtasib Al-Ulama Wal-Awliya, which is the regulator of the scholars and saints. And he really just is a spiritual master and gave us so many, you know, gems from the different texts that he's also produced. But his life story is actually also fascinating because he was orphaned when he was young. And he was actually raised by his maternal grandmother, who was also a scholarly woman in her own right. Her name was Umm al-Banin. And if you read some of the stories that he shares about her and how she would teach him really beautiful ways of teaching Islam to children, You know, he mentions in one of his, in his autobiography, he mentions one of his texts or one of the stories. He says that she told me that one night when I was 2 years old, I looked at a star and asked her who put it in the sky. And then she explained to me the duty of belief in that matter. She used to tell me anecdotes about the righteous and the reliant ones. And when she told me stories, she never told me anything except about the Prophet's miracles and the wonderful miracles of the devout. She also used to order me to pray even without performing the ablution. And when my maternal aunt once blamed her for this, she said, "Let him do so until he prays performing it." And I thought, you know, just that's one of many examples. You know, she would teach him about reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by, they were, you know, very simple family. They didn't have much, but she would hide food throughout the house and then tell him to supplicate with her, and that maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would put food somewhere, would give them, you know, sustenance. And then they would go on a little, you know, hunt looking for food, and then they would find it, and she would remind him to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he has all of these beautiful memories from his grandmother teaching him deen, putting him on the path of scholarship. She taught him how to pray. She put him in programs for him to, or, you know, madrasas for him to learn Quran and his deen. So he really gives a lot of credit to her for his path. And I think that's just really beautiful for us to also remember that many of our scholars, they had, you know, mothers, grandmothers, motherly women figures who were very much a part of their journey of Islam. And I think that should incentivize all of us to really take the path of studying knowledge seriously and to be passionate about it, and not to act as though it's the domain of exclusively men, because certainly that's just not the case at all. But I really love that he attributes so much of his success to his grandmother. So MashaAllah, there's a lot more to share about him, and there are biographies available. But just in the interest of time, because this is a 1 hour class, I wanted to go ahead and share with you now the PDF. And you also, hopefully all of you have that PDF, but let me go ahead and screen share here so that we can read it together. Now, Bismillah, again, why I love this text is because it is a roadmap, and it's just so beautifully organized, which also really impresses me, because I'm looking at, you know, 15th century, the fact that, you know, him and many, even Imam al-Ghazali and other scholars, I noticed that they had the foresight to, you know, to put their teachings, or to structure their teachings in a way that was really digestible to the reader, in this, you know, like bulleted point way of structuring, you know, everything they taught. And I've always thought that was so fascinating, because, you know, it's, you would think, you know, I think for in the way that we're educated now, that's common, but I just wouldn't know, or I didn't, I guess, think that, you know, people back then thought to do things like that, to actually organize like their teachings in this way. You know, I thought they would just be writing, because that's how it was always taught to us, that they produced so much, they were so prolific. So I thought they were more interested in just actually documenting and putting it all together, but to actually structure it in this way, I think is really amazing too. But so he starts off basically, and we can just read this together and then provide commentary, inshallah. But, you know, he starts off and he says, if anyone is asked about the foundation of his or her spiritual path, he should reply. And then he gives us the five foundations, and each one of them we could spend an entire session on really talking about, but we're going to again try to go through this, navigate this text together. But he lays out the foundation that if you are on this spiritual path, this path of Islam, and you're sincere, you really want to be a practicing Muslim, and you've finally come to that point in life where you really want to embrace your faith, inshallah we're all there, then you need to, these are the goals, these are the objectives, and these are the foundations. And so then, so let's read through them. So he starts off and he tells us first that taqwa, right? That the most essential prerequisite of being on a spiritual path is that we are mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you'll notice this as we continue to read, that he puts these caveats or disclaimers. That, because, you know, that's pretty understood. It's kind of like, okay, I understand taqwa. We're all taught that. But what I love is that he, you know, he mentions here, and I'm sorry, let me just quickly zoom into this text to make sure you guys can all read along with me. It's clear for me, but I realize now that it might not be for you. Okay, bismillah. So he says here, he puts the condition here. This is a conditional statement, right? So it's mindfulness of Allah, but how? Privately and publicly. And I think that's really important for us to reflect on, because, you know, it's easy if you think about it, because social pressure. And what I mean by that is, you know, whether you want to be a part of a group or you're afraid of being excluded from a group, you conform. And so it's easy when we're in social settings to play the part, right? We may behave actually even more religiously or more mindful of our behavior, of our words, of our language, of the way that the topics that we talk about, because we're in public settings and we don't want, obviously, the consequences of maybe unveiling certain parts of ourselves. And so we put on the persona, or, you know, that, and we all do it to a certain degree, but we have that nature, right, of doing that. So I love that he is reminding us that while that is, you know, easy to do, even the munafiqeen, as we know, were very convincing, you know, and they still are. Obviously, there's hypocrites that still exist amongst us. They're very convincing in that they show up, they come to the same spaces, and they perform, or they appear to perform, the same, you know, rituals that we do. But it's really about the hearts, and the true essence of a person's faith is known when they are alone. And I think that was really, again, it's when we say it now, as I'm saying it, I feel like it seems so obvious, some of these things, these insights. But I think to point it out and to make mention of it leaves really no room for doubt or question that this is exactly what we want. We want to have this degree of taqwa, where when we are alone by ourselves, that's when we are truly mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's not just that we play a part, but that we're actually sincere. And so that's, many of our scholars say that that in fact is you know, an indication, or if you want to know your state with God and you want to know where you are, then you have to pay attention to what you're doing by yourself. So when you're alone, no one else is around, there's no way for people to see you, do, you know, observe you, how are you using your time? What are you engaged with? And that is really an indication of your state. And then in terms of, you know, the broader meaning of taqwa, there's so many definitions, and, you know, there are technical definitions actually in this book, where the Foundations of the Spiritual Path was first printed, for my understanding, in English, was in the book Agenda to Change Our Condition. So if you don't have this text, this is actually a wonderful text as well, because it is really about doing what, you know, this text also discusses, which is changing and you know, coming to a point where you really want to start to practice your faith with sincerity. So they have, the first entire chapter is on the definition of taqwa and the benefits. And so, you know, there's different scholars who gave their own interpretations of what taqwa means, but I'll just read briefly here. So Sidi Abdul Wahid ibn Ashab defines taqwa as follows. The summation of taqwa is avoiding prohibitions and fulfilling injunctions, both inwardly and outwardly. And then in his book of definitions, Imam al-Jurjani defines it accordingly. Linguistically, it means to ward off. In other words, it is to take precaution. According to the scholars of truth, it is to protect oneself from the punishment of Allah by obedience to him. And it is to guard the self from Allah's punishment due to an omission of a right action or commission of a wrong action. What is intended in one's obedience is sincerity. And Ibn Ashur says that there's four aspects to taqwa. And he says that first, it's fulfilling obligations outwardly, fulfilling obligations inwardly, avoiding prohibitions outwardly, and avoiding prohibitions inwardly. So it's interesting again here is that even within the way that taqwa is defined, this condition is necessary, right? That we are mindful inwardly, outwardly, publicly, privately. All these conditions are embedded even in the concept of taqwa itself. So that's just, again, speaks to, you know, what your level of sincerity really is, because we can all say on our tongues that we fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we really are mindful of him, and that we want to obey him. But the proof, as they say, is in the pudding or in the actions, right? And so that is determined both privately and publicly. So that's the very first foundation. So we have to commit to that. And that's where I think, obviously, alhamdulillah, the month of Ramadan is a great time of spiritual reset for many of us, all of us, hopefully, for us to really come to terms with whether or not we're truly sincere. And so there's a lot of time where we're alone, and maybe we're not in our normal routines, because I know, you know, people take time off work. And usually, you know, there's adjustments made in our schedules for this blessed month, but we might find a lot that we have a lot more time on our hands now that we're not eating and drinking and socializing and going out and meeting friends and meeting family. And so what are we doing? You know, what are we doing? And so this is being the very first point, is something that we should all really take inventory of ourselves and our actions and where we have been over the course of our lives, and whether or not we can objectively and truthfully say that when we are alone, we are displaying taqwa. And I think that's a question we all have to ask for ourselves. Like, when we are by ourselves, are we mindful of our Lord, or are we distracted? And then the next question obviously would be, if we're distracted, what are we distracted by? And that's when we get to, you know, the practical steps of changing course, right? Because if we're not here yet, then inshallah, that's where we should be. And so we'll get to that later. But the next, point of the five, right? The next one he mentions is adherence to the sunnah in word and deed. Again, you'll see it's a conditional statement. So, you know, it's very easy for some of us. I mean, I was looking at, I recently moved, and so I have a lot of books in boxes still. And I was looking through some of my boxes and looking through some of my books, and I realized, ya Allah, may Allah be gentle with us and not take us to account for all of the things that we're not acting upon, right? Because I'm just overwhelmed with how many books I have. And I love books. I just yesterday went to a bookstore because I have a little bit of time, and I could spend a lot of time in bookstores because I love books. And I think a lot of us, you know, we may see ourselves like that, but then it's the acting upon the knowledge that we read or learn that is really important. So, you know, this concept of knowing about the Prophet ﷺ, so knowing his sunnah, right? Many people know his stories. Many of us have sat in classes. We've read his seerah. We've listened to lectures on his seerah. We've even taught our children or other children maybe, but we have definitely engaged with the sunnah on an intellectual level, right? And I think people, mashallah, I'm always impressed. Sometimes I meet people and they know, like, you know, the names of the Sahaba, like, just they know them intimately. They know so many details. But again, the true mark of taqwa, or of whether or not you're doing this right, is, are you acting upon the sunnah? Because it makes very little difference if you have all of that knowledge, but then in your actions, you're nowhere near trying to at least embody the Prophet. I mean, obviously, he's perfect. He's complete. He's our exemplar. And we may never achieve that level, but it's the effort that we're looking for. So if we're not even striving towards really changing our customs, our ways, and to adopt his ways, then that's a deficiency that we need to contend with and ask why. And this is where, you know, it takes a lot of self-reflection and knowledge. You know, you have to have knowledge of yourself in order to know what you're working with, right? So that's baseline. You have to know your temperament, your personality type, and then realize that in order to be more like, be more prophetic, like, you're going to have to make some adjustments, right? And so that is going to require a lot of internal spiritual work and self-development. You're going to have to face your blemishes. We all have them. We're all completely riddled with spiritual diseases and shortcomings and character flaws and vices, bad habits. We all have them. But again, when we say adherence to the sunnah in word and deed, it's being so aware of those things that you want to transform, and you're, and then you have obviously the example to model yourself after. So you're learning the sunnah of the Prophet and it should fill your heart with pride and love and joy for him, because that's also part of our faith, that we love him more than we love ourselves. We should do that. But the actual true example or manifestation of that love comes from adopting his sunnah and really ridding ourselves of anything that goes against his sunnah, certainly that. And then the other things that we have to modify and change and refine over time, we do it with the niyyah to try to be as much like him as we possibly can. So again, that's foundational. These are all the, you know, as you know, the example goes of a structure, of any structure, you lay the foundation first before you build upon. So that's what we're talking about here. This is what, these are the prerequisites that we need in order to then beautify our faith, right? The process that Imam al-Ghazali refers to as the three steps, right, of takhalli, tahalli, and tajalli. This is where we empty the nafs of disease and all these bad habits. And then we, you know, start to grow in our understanding and knowledge and beautify. And then we really aspire to be our the highest forms that we can be. So it's a process, but this is what's required to even get there. And that's why I think it's so needed right now. We need to really understand this roadmap that he's laid out for us. So adherence to the sunnah and word indeed, making sure that we know the Prophet's way, and then we're also modeling that. So the way, again, we walk, the way we talk, the way we eat, the way we dress, the way we deal with other people, the way our transactions with human beings. What? How is it? Am I just defaulting to my personality or the way that my family raised me, even if it's against the sunnah, and I'm comfortable in that and I don't really want to change? Those are the types of questions that we have to, again, contend with when we look at this point of making sure that our outward matches our inward understanding, our outward behavior. So then the third foundation, right? Indifference to whether others accept or reject one. And I love this point, again, because it's so relevant, especially in today's day and age when people, I think most of us, if not all of us, are so affected by, again, the social pressure, right? The social pressure can take over in many cases. And a lot of our motivations sometimes, a'udhu billah, are not for the sake of Allah. Our intentions are not for the sake of Allah. They are for trying to, either ingratiate or enter certain circles, be accepted by certain people, or that we have a fear of being rejected. And so when we let social pressure dictate our behavior and we're not really dealing, we're not facing our intentions or purifying our intentions, then that can compromise our good actions. And this is why, you know, further study of the spiritual diseases of the heart is so essential, because when you realize so many of the spiritual diseases actually have to do with intention, it has to do with the starting point of your actions, then it, and this makes a lot of sense. So being indifferent to whether others accept or reject one it takes a lot of internal work, because we have to overcome insecurities. And when you're dealing with real life, you know, situations, people have trauma from their family backgrounds, things growing up, maybe they're in relationships where they're not supported, they're not really encouraged, they don't have a lot of positive influencers. And I use that word very carefully, because I'm not talking about that word in the context of social media, but like people in your life that are really positive people. And it's sad, but a lot of people don't have positive people in their life. They have people who are detractors, or, as you know, they say, haters. A lot of negative energy people who tend to be more critical than positive. So what that can do for anyone, and especially if you really go back into a person's history and their upbringing and their childhood, this is how we, it's a breeding ground, right, for becoming more consumed with people pleasing, because we're looking for love, we're looking for validation. So you have, you know, people, and a lot of people, this is what's happened to them. Maybe they didn't get the love and validation from their parents or their other caretakers, or maybe, as I said, they had too much negativity, and so there was just this need for praise or acceptance that began at such an early age, and then it was never really resolved, and that continues into the adulthood. But you can see how that can spiritually compromise you if you're not dealing with those things. So really working internally to face your insecurities is really important. And then to kind of step back and start to really address how people, no matter how much they, goodwill they may have toward you, they don't benefit you. And that, I think, was, for me personally anyway, a very big realization, you know, that there are a lot of things that people do for us, and a lot of good that comes from human beings. But at the end of the day, they are the sebab, the means, right? The one who is providing those blessings and gifts, even the words that people share, compliments, kind words, dua, it all goes back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because every good goes back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every good. And so, and that doesn't mean that we don't acknowledge the good of people. That's certainly not what I'm saying, because lam yashkurinas, lam yashkurillah, we are taught to acknowledge the good that people do for us, the kind words, the support. But it's more about the metaphysical lens, right? Because you can see the world from a very worldly perspective, like, you know, just like, as they say, horizontally, what's happening. So you talk to people, you're engaging with people. And so you can just leave it at that level. But once you start to kind of zoom out a little bit and you see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who sent, that person to you at that time, or in, you know, that at that time of your life or in that moment, and he's the one who's directing, you know, it all. And so if, because for example, I'll give you an example. I've given talks, alhamdulillah, for a long time now, or I've written posts, sometimes my Facebook posts or my Instagram posts. I can't tell you, I have no way of even quantifying it, how many times I've had people come up to me and say, Jazakallah khairan, I read your post or I heard this, and I feel like you were speaking exactly to my problem, like exactly everything I needed to hear. I needed to hear this today. I get that sometimes almost, you know, on all my posts, I've seen some comment like that, or someone will give a feedback like that. And to me, that's just subhanAllah. You know, that's what we say, you know, divine will, divine providence. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just working through his creation. I believe truly in that. And I really believe that that person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is communicating, you know, to them directly. And so, you know, it's just an important lens to have. And it really does help you to rid yourself, when you can start to think in that way, of the need for human validation. Like, you don't look for it anymore, because you're just like, no matter what, it's not them, it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whether he sends those positive messages through people's words or actions, or it's manifest in the blessings that I cannot enumerate. We can never. I mean, I really think about this sometimes, and I'm like, subhanAllah, it's overwhelming. If you've ever done a gratification exercise where you sit, I'm sorry, not gratification, gratitude exercise, where you sit and you are trying to think about all the things that you're grateful for. It's happened to me several times before where I feel, I don't even know how to, like, what is happening? Is it a physiological, visceral reaction to the process? Is it a mental, spiritual? I don't know. I don't know, but I feel this, it's this overwhelming feeling, and all these things emotions are coming to the surface. And I actually have to, in a way, slow down, because I can see myself, if I were to continue, I don't know, maybe it would turn into something that I wouldn't know how to control, because, you know, sometimes these emotional states can arise out of these exercises. So I felt that before because I'm like, ya Allah, it's just never ending. And what I appreciate about, you know, our teachers, alhamdulillah, I remember years ago, like something that it never occurred to me in my entire life to think of was something that, you know, Shaykh Hamza had mentioned many, many years ago in one of his classes. I don't know what, but he was talking about this concept of gratitude to Allah and how much we should be doing this. And he said, you know, think about like your eyelashes. And you know, that kind of just, you know, started like this domino effect of thoughts that where I was like, yeah, because he was talking about like the blessing of eyelashes. And I was like, yeah, I've never once prior to that moment in time ever said, thank you Allah for giving me eyelashes. But then when he, you know, went on to describe the immense benefit of how eyelashes protect us and how, you know, there are so many people, and especially if you know people who have like alopecia or who are undergoing cancer treatment, they lose their hair. And so that also affects their ability to be out in public, because can you imagine, may Allah protect all of us, but if you don't have certain means to protect your, you know, your most important faculties, it would be very uncomfortable, right? And so people are suffering with these things all the time. So that was just a really interesting observation. But you see, if we're not thinking of these things, then we may never even get to that point of reflection, right? If we're not thinking that there's just too many things to be grateful for. So that once you start living in that way where you are seeing the Munim, right? The one who is the one who blesses us, all, or the source of all blessings. When all of your thoughts start to go back to him, that's when you break free from the shackles of needing constant human validation. And so this third point of being indifferent, so when people come and they compliment you, that it doesn't affect your heart where you are excited for that, you know, you may be like, alhamdulillah, and that should really be the response that you have internally, outwardly, alhamdulillah, and you mean it, like it's all from Allah. So, you know, deflecting compliments, sometimes people get into like, you know, and I think culturally also and socially, you know, there's a lot of insecurity around how do we receive compliments, because, you know, it's something that you want to know how to do properly, right? So how do you do it properly? Well, you give credit where it's due. And so we should always accept compliments because they're recognition of blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. So you don't have to, you know, negate a compliment. So someone says something nice about you, you don't need to, you know, go to that extreme of wanting to show so much humility that you actually start to negate the attribute itself or the blessing itself. We don't want to do that. No, don't say that. That's not true. We shouldn't do that. If people make observations, just say alhamdulillah, because that is haqq. That's haqq. We didn't do anything to warrant the compliment to ourselves, to attribute that to ourselves. No, nobody's done anything. Like all of it comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even your most, think of the thing you work the hardest to achieve, whether it's academic pursuits or, you know, other things that you may have accomplished in your life. No part of that can you truthfully and honestly say was from you alone. It's entirely by Allah's permission and his gifts and for you that you are able to do those things. So that's what this is about, getting to that point of, I just don't really feel moved either way by whether or not people accept me or reject me, because my only concern is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it takes a lot of, again, real deliberation to get to that point, but inshallah we all get there, because we're living in a time where I think, especially with social media and now the pressure of the political environment that we're in, where there's just a lot of suppression of our true values and beliefs because of fear, right? There's a fear that I'm going to be judged or canceled or somehow, you know, I'll get this thing taken away from you, from me. And that's, you know, where I think, unfortunately, a lot of things have it's fostered a lot of harm in our world when people just silently acquiesce and we don't really speak up or speak the truth. And not, you know, not our truth, as they say nowadays, where everybody has their own truth. We're talking about truth, haq, like speaking the truth. And of course, there's a way to do that. We have guidance on how to give, for example, nasiha, or how to speak truth, as they say, to power. There's always guidance on these things. But the point is not allowing the fear or the desire to be accepted by people or the fear of rejection dictate. And that is, again, foundational. So it's like, subhanAllah, you can see, and I don't mean to overwhelm anybody, but if this is the foundation of our faith, then you can imagine how beautiful, how much more is involved when we start to build upon that foundation. But if these are this is what our scholars are calling us to, the best versions of ourselves. So they're really helping us to, to cleanse these impurities from our soul, inshallah. So that's the third point. And the fourth point we have is contentment with Allah in times of both hardship and ease. And again, so beautiful, because this is in today's world, it's very easy to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when things are difficult, because it's a coping mechanism sometimes, which is good. I mean, there's nothing necessarily wrong with turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But I think a lot of us may naturally do that, right? And you can see that when a tragedy hits, people usually turn to their spiritual, practice or faith or whatever. It is, I'm speaking generally as human beings, right? If they have that, if they have faith. But the fact that he's put, again, this condition here, contentment, having rida with Allah when things are difficult too, not just, when things are difficult, but also when they're with ease. Because, I'm switching the two here. So I apologize. Let me backtrack. So this point is about contentment. So it's having pleasure with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being content with Allah during hardship and ease, right? And that's difficult because it's easy to be happy with Allah when things are going well, right? If everything's, smooth sailing, your personal life is great, your health is alhamdulillah, your children, your family, everything's in order, finances, I mean, you would expect nothing less than for you to be grateful and to be in a good state with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's kind of obvious. But what about when he withholds something? What about when you are put through a difficulty? Are you just as content? And that's really the question here. And it's very much tied with the last point here, which is they kind of are, you can go between them two. They're interchangeable. But the idea is consistency, right? That you're not, like, you don't treat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as though, I hate using this analogy, but it's the first thing that comes to my mind, as though, that he is there to just whip up like your dreams and wishes for you, that's all you think of when you think of Allah. And as long as he's doing that, like your prayers are being answered, your dreams are being fulfilled, your desires are being fulfilled, that you're happy with him. But once, things get a little harder and more difficult, that you suddenly start to turn away from him, you're now doubting, you're distrusting of his decree. Those are the types of things that I think, again, we have to be really addressed within ourselves. Do I do that? Do I feel constriction toward Allah, where I don't feel as open and as full of love because now I'm going through something hard? Or is it consistent? Because I realize that all of it is good, as the Prophet taught us, right? Alhamdulillah, ala kulli hal. Like that level of awareness, again, these are things that we're all hopefully aspiring to, but to see it all from him, that whether it's a tribulation in my personal life or khair, there's openings, it's all from Allah, and there's lessons that I'm supposed to glean from these events, instead of just wallowing or falling into a state of, again, distrust or disease, and I start to you know, question things. And that's, you know, these are, this is where paying attention to our thoughts, making sure that we have really good people around us who can help us, because Iblis, obviously, that's the other part of this. He will see us in those vulnerable states, and you know, he will magnify the hardships and minimize the blessings so that we start to fall into these really negative states. And so catching ourselves and saying, wait a second, where was I? You know, I mean, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was blessing me for years and years and years. And this is why learning, for example, the story of Prophet Ayyub alayhi salam and other prophets is so important, because they give us that perspective. Like, they lived years of abundance and joy and khair. And so when the hardships came, they weren't suddenly, you know, having a crisis of faith. They were totally accepting that this is from the same source. And so that's how we can contend with whether or not we have rida with Allah consistently. And then the last point, again, is very much tied, but it's really about action, right? Like, what is our protocol? So when you're in a state of prosperity, that Allah has given you all these blessings, right? Are you continuously turning to Him? Are you getting up every night for your, you know, the tahajjud and your prayers, making sure you're doing them all on time, as early as possible? Are you engaging with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Are you doing your daily adhkar? Are you doing that in times of prosperity? Or, as I was saying earlier, is it something that you do naturally or reflexively when things are, you know, when you're scared? There's a fear element, right? We go into panic mode. And we saw a lot of this, for example, during COVID. You know, you can just think back on the fear that took over so many people. Many people found faith, right, that they didn't have before, which is, alhamdulillah, good. Guidance in any which way is good, right? But it's about, you know, consistency. That if we're not, if we only, and I remember, like, it was like an ongoing kind of joke when I was in school or college, but finals week was the time where everybody was suddenly super religious, you know, because we're all worried that, you know, we want to get the best grade. So people start to pray, and some would even fast, and they were very serious because they were scared that, you know, I need to do well. And so I have to turn to God right now. But then as soon as they got, you know, the results, then they weren't doing the same. So that's the problem with, you know, the mind that doesn't understand that, really. And if you look at all five of these points, the message that I hope should be very clear to all of us is it's really about consistency. And every single point, he's emphasizing that you can't have this, you know, difference, this cognitive dissonance, or this, you know, outward and inward duplicity, where you're just a different person, you know, in private and public, and you're not consistent. Consistency is, again, I mean, it's one of the many beautiful virtues of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that we also need to be aware of, that he didn't have these dual sides. He was a very consistent person. And that's not to say that he didn't have his private life with his, you know, family more intimately than when he was in social settings. Of course, that's just natural. But we're talking about character. We're talking about, you know, one's lived experience being aligned with their faith, regardless of people. Right, regardless of who's watching, who's around. And I think it takes a great deal of practice, inshallah, to get there. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all tawfiq to get there. But again, what I love about this, you know, roadmap that Sidi Ahmad Zarruq has put out is he's laying it for us. He's given us the tools. He's given it to us, the criteria for what we need to really build upon. And so there's so much to explore with this, and there's a lot more to be said and shared. But let's read from this paragraph, and then we can maybe stop if there's some time for Q&A. Here's this paragraph that follows right at the bottom. It says, the realization of mindfulness of Allah is through scrupulousness and uprightness. So now he's giving us the practicum, right? Like, how do we actually do this? So if you want to have true taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to be mindful of Him. You have to be thinking of Him. And every moment you really can, if you try hard enough, You look at what you're doing, you know, in the moment, and we can maybe go through some exercises where we do this, but just how you can train your mind to like create a little trail that goes back to Allah. It's not difficult. It's actually easy to do. And I've you know, kind of in my own life forced that process because I wanted to try to do that. So at every moment, I'll try to find something, you know. I mean, obviously I'm not perfect and I definitely fall short, but it's something that if we're deliberate about, inshallah, we can do more than not doing it at all. So being mindful of Allah and is through scrupulousness and uprightness. So again, just being aware of oneself, being upright, having, you know, the understanding of what good character is and all of the virtuous behaviors that we should be embodying as Muslims, just following the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, which is the second point here. The realization of adherence to the sunnah is through caution and excellent character. The realization of indifference to others, acceptance or rejection is through patience and trust in Allah. And that's really, again, beautiful that we, because people will disappoint us, people will hurt us. So I think the more we learn to lower our expectations of the creation of Allah, then the more we will increase our expectation of the Creator. And that's really comes through patience and just taqwa and tawakkal, you know, just trust, putting our confidence in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? In shakartum la yazidannakum, if you're grateful, I'll increase you. So knowing that the gifts are coming, and then anandi thani abdi bi, all of these beautiful you know, teachings and principles of our faith that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is incentivizing us with, right? That if you I am in the opinion of my servant, so just be mindful but have the best opinion of Allah, and He will show you in due time. And then the realization of contentment is through acceptance to what one is given and turning over the management of one's affairs to Allah. So, you know, rida, again, it's a station to get to this point of really being content with Allah. And people are going to, we're all going to go through different struggles in our lives where this lesson may be really the point to make sure that we're getting this lesson, that maybe, for example, again, something may be withheld from us for some period of time. We may be in that limbo of uncertainty, which is very difficult if you've ever been there before. If you don't know if something is going to unfold a certain way, whether it's with your health or your personal, you know, your personal relationships, it's very difficult to be patient. But to surrender or to, you know, to turn over one's affairs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so beautiful, right? It's just such a beautiful concept that Allah, I'm incapable. I have no way of seeing this through. I can't see the future. I don't know what's in my good. And that's why Salat al-Istikhara is such a gift for us, because we are literally asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take over our affairs when we beseech Him in that way. But it's such a gift because it's true. And we are surrendering to our Creator. And that's what He loves to see. The more we surrender and show our confidence and faith in our Creator, the more content He is with us. And then that's where, you know, فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْأُسْرِ يُسْرًا إِنَّ مَعَ الْأُسْرِ يُسْرًا, you know, that the ease will come after the difficulty. But He sometimes puts us through certain trials to get to that level where we really have surrendered. So it's inshallah, may Allah give us all of that. Give us all that ability to get there, inshallah. And then the realization of turning back to Allah is through praise and gratitude in times of prosperity and taking refuge in Him in times of affliction. Again, beautiful, because the more mindful we are of Him and just constantly, alhamdulillah, you know, really being in that state of just abundant gratitude. And, you know, I actually like to call it even actionable gratitude, because gratitude isn't just saying alhamdulillah. I mean, it's part of it. It's shukr al-lisan, so it's the gratitude of the tongue, but it has to be deeply rooted in the heart, right? So shukr al-qalb is really more important, that you truly feel grateful to Allah, you know, that it's not just something you're saying. But, you know, and a good exercise would be the next time someone does something for you, catch yourself, because sometimes we'll say, thank you so much, jazakallah khairan, right? And we say it because that's social etiquette. You know, someone does something nice to you, you should say thank you. But how many of us take a moment and think about that? Like, I'll tell you, just on Friday, I just thought of it right now. On Friday, I was teaching. I teach, alhamdulillah, at a wonderful school, North Star, which is here in the Bay Area. Alhamdulillah, and many of our Rahmah founders and teachers are part of that school as well. Make dua, please, for the success of the school and all the students and families. But I was teaching there, alhamdulillah, and just at the end of the class, right when we're all about to leave, one of my lovely students comes and she hands me, let me see if I can get it for you. I think I have it. She hands me this beautiful bag. And first of all, this bag, I don't know if you can see it, not probably because I have a filter. Oh, wait, no, it's hiding my face. There you can see it. She gives me this beautiful bag. And if you know me, I love this Zilij print. I have a lot of things in my house with this print. And her mother actually, mashallah, is the one who put this gift together. So she knows my love for it. But I think she gave, mashallah, gifts to the teachers. And I was very fortunate to be counted among them, although I don't work full time. But anyhow, so she gives me this gift. And I just was like so taken aback, not because I was surprised at her giving me a gift. They're a very beautiful family. But, you know, I had been having one of those days, just feeling heavy. This is a heavy time for my family and I, there's just a lot of things that happened in our family. My father's 8-year passing anniversary will be in just a few days. My mother was, Allah yarhamha, and Allah yarhamhu, she was ill last year at this time. So I've just been feeling very heavy thinking about them. And, you know, she didn't know that. And I was, you know, just teaching mode. But she gave me this gift and it just like hit me, you know, with like real, because it's Allah, right? He's the one who puts, you know, these thoughts, you could say, in the minds of his creation. Like, you know, we meet people all the time. Someone thought of you, you know, and they put together a beautiful gift. And then they came without knowing at all that you were having a heavy day. And they gave you this beautiful gift and it's got so many wonderful things in it. And they had no idea that they were going to make such an impact on your heart. But when you step back and you say, alhamdulillah, that's Allah, right? He's working through his creation. That's the shukr al-qalb. That's what we should be aiming for. Like that degree of thank you, Allah. You see us. And you remove pain in this way. You know, so that's where the gratitude moves from the tongue to the, it's in the heart. And then it's the actions that you do that follow, right? The dua that you make for that family, you know, the well wishes that you wish for them. And then inshallah, maybe you'll have the opportunity to gift them as well, right? The had of the habu. We should be giving gifts because this will increase love for one another. The Prophet ﷺ taught us. So this is real gratitude, right? That we have that awareness that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always the one where every good that we have is from Him. There's nowhere else that, you know, that you can attribute the good of your life. Nobody else. Your parents, yes, they're, again, the means, but it's Allah who blessed you with those parents. So, alhamdulillah, being mindful in times of prosperity, and then when things happen, right, when calamities hit, which they will, that we immediately turn to Allah. That our first thought is, Ya Allah. And I'll give you again an example. You know, when my mother, Allah rahma, was in the hospital last year, there was a period where, and I'll just share this because it's relevant and I'm already an emotional mess, so why not? But subhanAllah, when there was a point where she was in the hospital, and this was before we knew the gravity of her state, we didn't know what was going to come. So there was a lot of momentum, and you know, we were looking forward for treatments and all of this. And so I had spent some time in the hospital with her. And at one point I needed to go home because I slept basically at the hospital in the car. I was just there for a few days, alhamdulillah. And I decided I need to come home for a break to basically freshen up. And then I was going to go back. So I sought her permission. She was still, alhamdulillah, awake at that time. And I said, I'll be back. I just need to go, you know, and it was a bit of a drive. I said, I'll be back. And so I came home, and this is where, again, Allah, he's going to test you. I had just seen her. I just spoke to my mother, and my sister was with her. She was not alone. Everything seemed fine. I came home. I saw my children and husband after a few days. I went to freshen up and shower, and I came out, and it was about a 15-minute window. And this is what I mean when calamity strikes. 15-minute window of me feeling somewhat like, you know, normal, as you can say, because I felt like I was in an alternate universe. When I came out, my phone was just buzzing. Like, it was blowing up with message after message after message. And I was like freshly out of the shower. I'm just trying, and I see these messages, and I immediately was like, ya Allah, because it was my sister was with my mother, and she had an unfortunate issue come up, and it was very, very serious. Basically, she had cardiac arrest while my sister was in the room with her. And so I'm seeing these text messages completely, I just was calling on Allah, and I immediately ran out of the house. I don't know, record time. I got in my car, and the entire car, I cried more in that maybe than I ever have in my life. And I just begged him to please not take her from us. I couldn't even bear the thought of that. Like, it was, I just saw her, how, and I just said, please don't take her suddenly from us. I can't, we're not ready. I don't know what to do. And I begged and I begged. But my point in sharing is the doctors were with her. She's in a hospital. The nurses were there. My sister, family members were there for her. Nobody could help her. Nobody helped her in that moment. Allah does with his dominion what he wills. And he, in the moment that I left, just, you know, put her and all of us through that test. But it's, again, he can do that. Our response to that is where we show our belief in him. And I just, for me at that point, it was like, ya Allah, you're the only one. I can't call on anybody at this point. And alhamdulillah, you know, we got to the hospital, and although she suffered an incident, was very serious, code blue, all of it, the whole thing, alhamdulillah, they had stabilized her, and she was again awake. And it was just like, oh my God, thank you, Allah. Thank you for hearing us. Thank you for accepting our dua, that this, please don't take her from us. But, you know, it wasn't long after that he took his creation back. He called her back, and that was his will. And we had to, as a family, deal with that. That was our test, but this is life. This is dunya. So in times of affliction, the only refuge is Allah. And I'm telling you from my experience, that was the hardest test of my life, weeks at the hospital, but you can ask the people closest to me in my life. I really couldn't even talk to people. You get to a point where you realize I just need Allah, and that's it. And the Quran was my best friend. And the prayer mat was my best friends. And that's what we need to really realize. If we want to get through the trials of this dunya, refuge is Allah. He's the only refuge we need. Alhamdulillah. So I think I did. I went over. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to do that. But Ustadha Fadwa, if we have time to go over some questions or comments, I'm happy to stay a little longer, maybe 10, 15 minutes.
Thank you, Ustadha Hosai, for that beautiful introduction to the text, as well as just kind of laying the foundation for us And it wouldn't be a class with you, Ustadha Hosai, if you didn't share something to really move our hearts. Let's take a few moments to answer some of these questions that we have. We have questions in both the Q&A as well as the chat. Just going forward, it's easier for us to follow the questions in the Q&A because the chat is moving. So if you put your questions in the Q&A, it's easier for us to follow. Would you like me to read the questions or do you want to?
Sure. If you want to point me to the questions that you vetted, that's helpful too. Or you can read them, however.
Okay. I'm just going to start with the Q&A just as a sort of disciplining. That way we know the students next week, inshallah, will use the Q&A. So I'll start there. It says, Assalamu alaikum, Ustadha Hosai. Can you please address the idea of spiritual bypassing in the context of detaching from dunya? How can we strike a balance in being emotionally present and available in this life while working towards our akhirah, not becoming flooded by dunya?
MashaAllah, great question. Jazakallah khairan. You know, it's something that I think maybe the easiest way that I can answer it is, you know, there are others who've written on this topic of just becoming more self-reliant and the detachment process. But I did write an article that for me, it was kind of my own way of coming to this point of realization that I really want to not have these attachments. And so I wrote an article for a Medina Institute. Let me see if I can find it, but I feel like it really does help on this topic of how we can move away from our attachments of dunya and become more self-reliant, all based on the sunnah. This is actually a prophetic practice. And he encouraged us to not have attachments to even people and to not ask for people of things. You know, these are things that I think more of us need to speak on. And I know it's a delicate balance because obviously we're in the world, we have relationships, we have to, you know, we're constantly, there are rights that we have over people and obligations. So there is this, balance that we have to find. But I think I feel like so much of this gets resolved when we adopt a mindset and then we're fixed in that mindset. So our mindset has to be that metaphysical akhirah mindset. And once you have that mindset, then the other things kind of just start to make sense. So I'll try to find the article, inshallah. Let me see if I can do that.
You can also share it next week, but if you find it in the meantime, we can always share via email.
Okay. It should be week. Quick.
Okay, quick. In the meantime, I'm gonna read you the next question, inshallah. It says, MashaAllah, Ustadha Hosai, everything you have said is on point and relatable. You mentioned the lack of love as a younger child that manifests as we become adults in society. How can we stay strong when we still seek the love from our parents, knowing we can't force anyone to love us in an affectionate way? But I guess my question is more pertinent to the patience needed to accept this. Being a daughter of immigrants posed the effect of receiving love in the means of meeting our basic needs and meeting our educational needs, but there was always a lack of love in a relationship.
Yeah, mashallah. I think, you know, I can also, in a way, speak about this because, you know, when you have multi, sibling families, you can, some children, it's all like mentioned, Shaykh Hamza actually mentioned this recently about like hierarchies that even within family systems, birth order, there are hierarchies. So some children get more love and others just don't. And I think some of us may have even had that experience where we get lost in the shuffle because there's too many and parents can only do so much, especially immigrant parents who are dealing with all the challenges of coming to a new country and starting over. So being forgiving that it's not personal, because sometimes we personalize things because it, you know, speaks to the insecurities we may have, and maybe we have core memories that are really hard to erase. So we start to build like a narrative, but at the end of it, when you have a more broader holistic view of things, you start to see that I'm personalizing. In my case, for example, my mother, I mean, we're Afghani. And so she came from the Pashtun culture that was not very demonstrative. It was not a very affectionate, for women anyway, you know, some of our women are very tough women. And so my mother, growing up, she was, you know, tough, but she was also tough because she was put in a very difficult situation to raise five kids, leave her home country, leave everything behind, not speak the language, have to barely, you know, survive on whatever means that my father could produce. She was a homemaker. So she had all of that context that as a child, you're not aware of, you're not cognizant of, but as an adult, you are. So for myself, I started to really once I had children, start to see my mother in a very different light growing up than I did when I was younger, which I did feel I was, the fourth in line. And, my mother and I, we kind of had our differences growing up in my teenage years. So, and I was a bit of a black sheep, I came to Islam and I did a lot of things that didn't, I kind of broke the pat or the expectations, I guess. I challenged some of those expectations. So anyway, my point is it wasn't until later on when I started to really see how much my mother went through, and that empathy that I had for her made me realize I personalized so much that was not personal. My poor mom, like, she was just trying to survive. And that actually completely changed my relationship with her. And we became very close, alhamdulillah, up until her passing. Alhamdulillah, I'm very grateful to Allah. I was able to take her to Umrah. Alhamdulillah, we had a lot of great times together, just talking. She would call me for therapy because after my father passed away, Allah rahmahu, she really had a lot of emotions. And so we had a different connection. But you have to find the empathy within yourself to see your parents as they're not always deliberate. Inshallah, nothing is ever deliberate. I mean, that's not to say there aren't, and I'm not speaking about your parents, but there are parents who, a'udhu billah, may have harmed their children. May Allah forgive them. But I think a lot of our parents may have inadvertently caused harm, but the niyyah wasn't to harm. And once you come to that point, you can forgive them. But then also the other part of it, which is Allah. To start to prioritize, the love that you have for Allah and wanting His rida for you just starts to make your human relationships, yes, important, but not as important. Because when Allah becomes your focus, then He will start to fill you with a level of, again, rida within yourself that will heal a lot of these wounds. And I'm speaking from personal experience. I've lived through a few different things in my life where I feel like it's only the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that healed those wounds for me. Nothing else. Only the love of Allah. Alhamdulillah.
Jazakallah khair. There's sort of a flip side question to this idea of, it says, how do you navigate family environments where there is an unset expectation to make appearances when you are someone that has the mindset of, I have no need to please others or look for praise in those environments? So sort of like that little switch, if you're only looking to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then in that way, you have no need to please others or look for praise in the environments. How does that, I can see that sort of as like going too far to one side on, the flip side. How would you address that?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Is this in the, I want to read this question.
It's in the Q&A.
Is it already answered or is it open?
No, it's in the open. Open,
tab. Family members where there is an unsaid. Okay. So I'm assuming, I don't know, sister, if this is the case, but I'm assuming maybe you are a trophy child, right? Because sometimes our parents like to showcase us for different reasons. So if you find that you're being used in that way, and it's putting you, it's kind of making you maybe, like it's difficult to reconcile your niyyah because of it, then I would just say, make your intention better. If it's your parents that are asking you to do things, but you're not in it for the praise, you don't really want to do things for others to know or acknowledge you, but you're doing it for your parents, then just make it your niyyah that I'm doing this for the sake of Allah to please them so that they are pleased with me, because that is also a huge part of our faith, that we seek out every opportunity to praise our parents. And if it means, kind of putting ourselves in awkward situations for their sake, as long as internally there's no conflict, there's no ulterior intention, then there shouldn't be an issue. And inshallah, Allah accepts your niyyah. Because you're doing it for that beautiful intention. I hope that was in line with the question.
Yeah, I think you brought it back to Bir al-Walidain, which is a really good reason to do things. Sometimes we feel like, we don't want to because it may put us out there or we're showing off or something. But if you can just bring it back to just putting joy in the heart of your parents, it goes Absolutely. A long way in terms of our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Absolutely.
There's one last one. When struggling with low self-esteem, more often than not, You find the confidence in people's words and acceptance to what you've done. And when they don't, you start to question where you went wrong. How do you shift that reliance back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not what people say to you or about you?
Yeah, that's a great question. And again, I'm giving you like real lived experience here because, you know, as you know, being in a public figure, you end up getting a lot of attention from people. And so then there is a time, I remember before I even understood the diseases of the heart, where I absolutely, I know I did. I had, you know, riya for sure, suma, probably all the diseases of the heart that deal with wanting to be known and recognized and people saying things to you and complimenting you. I had all of it. And like you said, you kind of grow a dependency on it. And then when they don't do it, you start to doubt yourself. But over time, as I said, when you start to peel back the layers and see that sometimes, you know, people are, they just, you know, they say things that maybe they're genuine. Maybe they're just saying that because that's an expectation that they think that you need to hear something, you know, but it's not always necessarily true. You know, some people do flatter. People do give empty compliments. It's just the fact. So I have just over the years realized, like, I, inshallah, and may Allah always keep it so, but I don't put a lot of weight in the compliments that I receive. I'm very self-critical. So for me, it's whether or not, you know, I feel like I put my best effort into something. If I did something with, inshallah, ihsan, with itqan, and I feel that I put my best effort, then I feel the taysir will come, you know, the facilitation comes, the tawfiq comes, but I don't necessarily look for, you know, the compliments. I'm looking at it more like, you know, in terms of the effectiveness, the impact. So I think looking at the impact of your actions is more important than looking at how people perceive you as a result of what you do or say. Like, you know, and I'm speaking from a very personal experience, but I think generally just no longer seeking people's praise because you realize like there's very little value in what someone says to you if it's not true. And the true way, the true measure of yourself is with Allah. Like how, you know, because people could think all sorts of things about you. They could think you're the nicest, most pious person ever. But if that's not true, then why did that compliment impact you, right? It's just a perception. Whereas the truth, it's like a mirror. The truth is your, you know, relationship with Allah. And if you're striving, you're working hard, you're getting up, you're doing what you're supposed to be doing, you're self-critical, you're doing your muhasibah, then that is a greater indication of your truth and your true essence and value than anything that anybody has to say about you, no matter who that person is, because they don't know you. The only one who truly knows you is your Lord.
Jazakallah khairan. If you could just end with the closing dua for the...
Sure. Yes, jazakallah khairan again. And I'm sorry that I didn't get to all the questions, but if there's a way to maybe log these questions...
We hit all of them.
Okay, and even in the chats, because if there's anything in the chat that I didn't get... Yeah, please.
No, I did. Okay.
All right, jazakallah khairan. All right, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wal asr inna al-insana lafi khusr illa alladhina amanu wa amilu salihati wa tawasaw bil haqqi wa tawasaw bis sabr. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اشهد ان لا اله الا انت استغفرك واتوب اليك اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا ومولانا وحبيبنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى اله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا سبحان ربك رب العزه عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله جزاكم الله خيرا everyone inshallah we will see you next week at the same time on Monday and if there are any other questions you have please send them our way thank you so much Thank you, Ustadha Fadwa.
Thank you. And inshallah, we'll send out a one-day reminder and a one-hour reminder for class, as well as the link for the text in via email. So it should come from Zoom and it will have this, it'll be the same link. And please encourage others to log on and join this wonderful class, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Jazakallah khairan.